Because it was Father's Day, my children have a tradition of contacting their father, and they all checked in.
Yes, some of you may have seen in the newspaper, Martha and I just celebrated a wonderful event, and so we have $50 here for Relay for Life for 50 wonderful years of marriage as of June 12th.
Martha, is there a rebuttal? Past, present, Bertha Minor.
One happy buck. I'm sitting by my dear friend, Jim Sorensen. His wife retired this year, and now he's going to have quality time for the rest of his life. Maybe Monty will come over.
For those of you who never thought you would see a birth with a friend, here you go. Yeah, I know. Past Mr. Governor Mark.
President Ron, fellow Lions and guests, the first dollar is kind of sad, kind of happy. I was hoping to give this last week, but in memory of passing of a couple of people that I knew well, Tom Hutchinson was a longtime friend, my roommate on our ski trips, a teammate on the men's soccer team, we had to see him pass away. And Ben Gale, that some of you may have known, but he was in the paper from Rainier that was discovered in Washington, that's my wife's uncle. Top stretch there. Second is, in honor of Father's Day, I got up in the morning, took my wife out to breakfast, then I took her shopping, and I came home and she had offered some honeydew, so I did honeydew.
Fortunately.
And I asked if there's any kind of special dinner, and she said, no, they can TV dinner, so I bring the TV dinner. So most of you are wondering, Father's Day really is just like Mother's Day. Third dollar is for the Go Forth Parade. I've never been in the parade before. George was instrumental in kind of convincing me as one of the people to apply for a position at the county. I'm now the program communications manager. As part of that, I suggested that we outreach more, and one of those things is the parade. So I'm in the parade instead of being in the ministry.
Does anybody have a happy, are there any happy dollars that you're not married to Ellen Kelch? Hi, Dolly.
Hey.
Hello, Dolly.
President Ron, fellow Lions and guests, just to touch on what Mark Hells just said. On Mother's Day, Doug says, well, I'm not your mother. And I said on Father's Day, well, Doug, you're not my father, so here's the dollar.
Normally find that each Lions group does something different kind of thing, other than the site we're here in, which is kind of the larger one. But, you know, I think it's like the Columbia Cross Lions, so it's why I work with Salvation.
You're making an announcement? So you said you were. Well, don't put you down. Maybe we're just aprons or aprons or something.
Okay. Are there like giant regional Lions meetings where all the groups come together?
They do have regional meetings.
It's just like thousands of people show up.
The temporary storing thing would explain a lot around this room. People can't get out of here. Past President Jim. K-Line Ron, the Bell Lions, I guess, two happy bucks. One is for Donnie. Bert didn't introduce Donnie, his daughter, but she's this fantastic person. Hey, you know, yeah, there's no explaining. It must be her mother's DNA. But, you know, I do want to give another happy buck. Dolores, his beautiful wife, recently celebrated her 90th birthday. And I asked her, what is the, you know, explanation for your happiness? What is the true formula? And she said, well, marry a much older man. Lion Jan.
King Lion Ron for one more week. Fellow Lions and guests, had a great Father's Day. The kids all got together and they bought me a Traeger pellet grill.
Whoa. So what time should we be there? About 6 o'clock? 6 o'clock, Jan's house. Pass on to your drawer.
Jim has a husband.
He is a past president.
President Ron, fellow Lions and guests,
I didn't know that.
Just happy to be here, and I'm also looking forward to our nice warm weekend.
Okay.
That'd be easy. That'd be more accurate.
Yeah.
Council Chair Greg.
Stand up, Greg.
I'll have to do this next week. We got a bunch of stuff on today.
Last week, I made a real quick announcement that we got that little wagon all painted and everything, and my happy dollar is for the guys that helped me out. Hey, read their names. Dick Sorensen, Steve Patterson, Duncan Wallace, Jan Searing, Steve Johnston, Sam Wardle, Ron Johnson, Rex Boswell, and Bob Speck. Those guys did a great job on that one.
Lion Kurt.
King Lion, Ron Fellow Lion, I guess I have two happy dollars.
It seems like yesterday I was announcing the birth of my oldest son, Alexander, and then when he started school and those type of things, birthdays. And this last weekend, happy dollar, he graduated from college, Central University. So, all right, great. Son is home for the summer. This is Sam, and he's helping me in the office. And he's going to be a senior at Washington State.
That's President Tom.
King Lion, Ron, fellow Lions, and guests. My wife this weekend gave me this shirt. And said, you know, kids are afraid or whatever, but grandpas know everything. So I know everything. So I want you to remember that, George.
I thought it was know it all, but. Why, Leroy?
Leroy!
Keyline Ron, fellow Lions and guests. 6 weeks from today, that's going to be August 4th, my wife and I and our two kids are much more further than that, from are on our way along with about 15 other high school and college students. We're taken to Chiang Mai, Thailand. And that 6 weeks is the plan we've been missing for over a year now. And I can't believe that 6 weeks we're on our way. Yeah, in August. A little bit of rain. They say it's all sunny and hot until rain breaks out. So it's pretty good. Past Council Chair Hal.
Hey, thank you, past Tail Twister. Oh, almost past Tail Twister. Whatever your name is, Phil. President Ryan of Lions and Guests. First happy dollar. I think this is both Father's Day and the day that I turned 68.
What?
Can you believe it?
Yeah.
You know, as I was walking in here, hey, I'm one of those old guys that all you young guys are talking about. And then a super happy dollar. My oldest daughter gave me a Kindle Fire for my birthday, so I'm excited about that.
We got a Traeger grill, a Kindle Fire. There's all kinds of dangerous stuff going on. Really? Pass zone chair, Terry.
King Lion, Ron, yes, got a couple of happy dollars. First is, I'm in a coffee club, and we haven't been meeting for the last 2 weeks because of vacations and stuff like that. Went today, the only one I found was Phil, we turned around and the other happy dollar is that I was down in Denver, cleaned out some of the stuff out of my mom's house, and maybe we'll sell that thing one of these years.
Past, present, past. Seniority rules.
President Ron, fellow Lions guest. A nice Father's Day. I got a call from Little Lion Sam, who had just arrived that morning in Central Mexico on his mission trip. And while the conversation was a little broken up because of cell phone reception, he was at least able to tell me happy birthday or happy Father's Day. The funny part is my two older kids waited on Monday.
Oh, geez, it's Father's Day. Oh, no, I'm happy. Hey, thanks for giving us life. You know,
yeah, one of those kind of things. The second part of the greatest part of the of Father's Day was that I went and helped my friend Steve throw 300 bales of hay onto a trailer and then 300 bales off of the trailer into the
barn again, and the only thing that really is good about that is I know there's a good steak in my future.
I'm Carrie Ann.
President Tom, fellow Lions and guests, I am just happy to be back and sorry it's been so long.
Lion Brenda.
I saw it. Oh, I have a backpack and a happy back. President Ron, fellow Lions. I was scraping my grass and found out that I had dry rot in my grow.
Oh.
And I was poking around on my front porch, and I had dry rot in my front porch, and the cover over my porch. And I already knew I had dry rot in my utility. I'm afraid to poke around on the back porch. But the good news is, I'm having a dry rot party, and you're all invited.
Lion Roger.
Hey, Lion Ron. There's a happy dollar to see Tom here. I did tell him he looked pretty good for whatever happened and all he went through, but he's never really looked very good.
Welcome. Any more happy dollars?
Right here.
Where?
She sat down and left
it. Right up front.
Past President Marie found a dollar in Walt's wallet.
No. President Brock, fellow Lions and guests. I have a happy buck. I'm going to divide it into two things. We went to Seattle this weekend and had a great time with our kids, granddaughter, and golden retriever puppy, Kono. And the other happy buck is that I've got Walt out at the farm spraying weeds.
All right.
President Rockville Lions, I guess I have $1. I don't know if it's happy or sad. I went at 10:30 yesterday to meet Ryan John, who is going to be a tail twister next year, to teach him everything I know. And he wasn't there. So I can only assume that he already knows everything he needs to know. Turns out one of us was wrong. He was there at 10, I was there at 10:30, and we didn't see each other. Any dollars from the head table? No.
We're all sad.
President Ron.
Well, I get this meeting started, but have no gavel.
Who's your gavel?
Immediate past president. What do you have in your hand?
That's so great.
You know, most presidents after 1 year are willing to give that thing up. Woohoo! Take my cap.
Hey, Larry Hansen's going to give the invocation.
Our Heavenly Father, we come before you praising you and thank you for the wonderful blessing and the fellowship we have today, while we share in the food that you can strengthen us. For our calling as Lions to be a community service, we ask Lord for direction and guidance in all things. And we give you thanks and praise for what you give us to do. And we ask you.
Amen.
Amen.
Terry Kegler's going to do the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Marilyn Patterson on the song.
Our country is of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of thy pilgrims' pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring.
Do we have a sunshine report? Do we have any guests?
President Ron, fellow Lions and guests, we have Larry Hansen as a guest. Want to introduce her?
I'll introduce her.
You'll introduce her later. Okay. Rex Boswell has a guest.
Eli Ron, fellow Lions guest. Both daughters, Lily.
Harold Malone has a guest.
President Ron, fellow Lions and guest. My brother Luke is here today.
Oh, very good.
Bert Gravel has a guest.
We have a board meeting coming up this here Thursday, 7 a.m. at the carriage. Past President Phil Olson has a special award to give out.
I want to be a lion. I need to go find my local chapter. They're just so much fun.
Josh. Past Council Chair Hal, would you please rise? Yes, you do.
Two weeks ago,
we honored the Harveys for creative advertising. Unfortunately, Hal didn't wear the billboard today. But imagine if he was wearing Columbia Security. What cheap advertising. I mean, I don't know that you're getting paid more than the minimum wage, are you?
Minimum wage less all the mistakes.
Okay. The other thing.
I over.
The other thing is, past Council Chair Hal is a candidate for International Vice President.
No, Director.
Director. And you might wonder, is it possible to be elected to that high office without wearing a Lions pin to the club? And when you're on your club security,
you know, I violate all their rules, I get fired. And all
so that. This certificate is awarded for your valuable contribution and wink, wink, nod, nod to Lions International.
Past Sole Chairman Greg Firth has an announcement.
President Ron Lions and guests, got signed up sheets back here at the bar table for the concession wagon down at the lake. There's a lot of empty spaces on that. The truck wagon is by far our largest money maker. That's how we're able to put money back into the community, put thousands of dollars into eyeglasses and hearing aids, build wheelchair ramps, scholarships. Anyway, we need help. Please sign up. Multiple shifts if you possibly can. Thank you.
Marilyn Patterson has an announcement.
President Ron, fellow Lions and guests, I just wanted to remind you that I keep stock on the Pioneer Lions clothing, t-shirts and jackets, things you might need at the 4th of July or any time that you're representing the Lions. So I have to leave early. If you want something, either see Steve afterwards or give me a call.
Greg Swanson has an announcement.
Yeah, I get second. President Ron, fellow Lions guest. I get second place behind Firth here on the table. My other table, two tables over here, are lined with sign-up sheets as well for the Spirits of Longview. And there again, we've got a lot of open slots, and we've got a lot of different, from selling tickets at the gate to selling chips, moving chips around, managing the money, to clean up, set up, everything. So please sign up if you can. There's always a job you can do. It doesn't have to be a backbreaking job. We can move you around, but we need your help. So sign up. Be generous of your time. Thank you.
Bass District Governor Mike Parker has an announcement.
Yes, you do. King Lion, Rod, fellow Lions, and yes. I'm starting
to look for a relief driver for the screening unit. It'll be relief for a few months and then it'll work into a full-time job because I think sometime next year I'm going to retire. So if anybody at all is interested, at one time my boss said he had to have a CDL before you could even apply, and I'm not going to go with that. You get the CDL after you get trained. But if anybody's interested, see me after the meeting, call me on the phone, call me on my cell, 206-484-0198. I've got that phone with me all the time, except in here, so it doesn't ring. So you guys can go ahead and try to get me fine. It's out in the car. Sam.
Do we get to travel with Pat?
Ask her, Sam.
Harold Malone has an announcement.
Get a lot of applications if you say yes.
President Ron, fellow Lions and guests, like these other gentlemen, I have sign-ups too, or there's sign-ups to play golf. And I know that there's two or three people in here that probably want to have a team. We have now, I think, 8 teams. We have 2 more potential teams for 10. We need a bunch more. So please sign up. July 25, we play.
Dick Sorensen has an announcement.
President Ron, fellow Lions and guests, 2 things I'd like to announce. Number one is, as you're all aware, we dumped the newsprint and that magazine container last week. We had a little bit more tonnage in there than we've had in the past, but NORPAC only gave us $100. And the reason what they've done with Lions groups and other groups is they've, over the years, they've paid us $115 a ton, and the minimum would be $100. So this year, all we were getting was $100 for our, which was about $1,160, I think. So thank you very much. And I know I announced it, and I also put a paper down there in the container, so if anyone has questions about what they can drop off or whatever, let's post it down there, and I'll try to bring one with me every time. Also, last thing I have is this Thursday, 8 a.m. is Campus Tower, so if anyone wants to join us, you're welcome to come. Thank you.
Dolly Harvey has an announcement.
President Ron, Phil Lyons, yes. I'm interrupting here because I want to finish. Short meeting for the spirits of Longview up here after the meeting here.
Okay. President Ron, Phil Lyons, and guests, once again, I have some Go 4 buttons. They're going fast, so only 210 left.
Past President Doug Harvey has an announcement.
President Ron, fellow Lions and guests, another announcement that a week from today, 6:30 at Terry's Restaurant, 32nd Ocean Beach, we're having our zone kickoff. And our theme this year is going to be Nine United. I have to come to the meeting to find out what that's all about. Next Tuesday night.
Thank you.
Past President John Claypole has an announcement.
Thank you, President Ron. Fellow Lions and guests, I am first starting the kids' races. The kids' races sign-up sheet. Woody has it in his hot little hands, but he'll let it go in a second. The awards committee at the last board meeting presented our nominees for Lion of the Year, Unsung Lion of the Year, and Rookie Lion of the Year for 2014-2015. And it's my honor to announce their names here at Club. They aren't going to be given their awards until probably mid-July, but I want the people that I'm calling on to stand up. In this club, it's a great honor just to be nominated because of how many hardworking Lions there are. No, they're just hardworking, Phil. I've never seen any industry around here. Maybe for Tom Wright, but I don't know. In no particular order, and you're going to know this is true, this is the first nominee for Lion of the Year, Bill Pontius. Remain standing if you can, Bill. The second nominee is Lion Marilyn Patterson. And lastly, our secretary, who is in absentia today, Keith Luff. Thank you, Lion. Our unsung Lions of the Year are Bob Speck, Steve Johnston, and Lion Dwayne Smith. And the awards committee also did something unusual this year. We have four nominees for Unsung Lion of the Year. We had to do it a little bit sub rosa because we didn't want to get in any trouble. But past President Maurice Speck is also Unsung Lion of the Year. I remember afterwards. Our rookie Lions of the Year that have been nominated, and please stand, Eric Lipke, Lion Sarah Kalal, and Lion Brenda Corser. Again, these Lions form the core of our workers that we are able to recognize. we thank them very much, and it's an honor, as I said again, just to be nominated in a club this large. Thank you, Lions.
Who won?
Technically.
That's it. Rex Boswell has an announcement.
I do also have some sign-ups for ice cream. We got a real busy weekend coming up. All the help we can get. Then also, next Monday, I'm looking for anybody that wants to come down to Lions Island and do some cleanup for a couple hours. Y'all can eat his gloves and maybe a lawn rake. The city of Longview will be down there with their dump truck to pick up all the garbage and leaves and everything. About 7:30 a.m.
Well, there's no more announcements. I'll turn this meeting over to Larry Hansen.
Can you use this one?
I probably can just use the microphone.
I'll introduce my special guest now, President Ron and Phil Lyons' guest. Her name is Abigail Cermak, and she's coming all the way from the Portland to Halton area, where she lives and works. But she's also a volunteer, and part of what she does is watch over things like Columbia River, which is a special part of the Columbia River and called the Hanford Reach, which is, I think, a beautiful area of the state of Washington. But like all beautiful areas, it needs special care, and we all need to be aware of some of that. Abigail originally comes from the Michigan area. She moved out here and graduated from a local school in her master's degree in Portland State, actually, I believe.
Yeah.
And she works for the city of Portland, like I mentioned, also helping people do environmental cleanup around the Portland area, like you see around here, like old gas stations that need to be recycled and things of that nature, which is a special project also. She's also not a Lion right now, but she's looking for one that she might join in the Wallaston area. So if you know a good one in the evening clubs you can refer to her to, she would appreciate that too. Without further ado, I'll introduce Abigail to you.
Thank you, Larry. Are you all done?
Thank you, Larry, for inviting me, and thank you all for having me here today. I love coming to Lions Clubs because they're so much fun. And I rarely get to say the Pledge of Allegiance, and so this is like my, you know, opportunity to honor my country when I come out to Lions Clubs, which is great. So my name is Abigail Cermak. I'm the Hanford Coordinator with Columbia Riverkeeper. As a public interest group, it's Riverkeeper's mission to protect the Columbia River and all life that is supported by it. And one of the ways that we do this is by providing cleanup oversight on the Hanford Nuclear Reservation. We look at the cleanup plans, offer recommendations, but probably most importantly is that we bring information about Hanford out to the public so that citizens like yourselves can get involved in the cleanup decisions that are happening out there. So before I go on, I always like to see hands go up. Who's familiar with Hanford? Lots, it's great. Has anyone ever worked at Hanford or knows anyone that works out at Hanford? And has anyone been out to the area? Maybe toured the B reactor, been on the river on the Hanford Reach? Great, so there's a lot of people familiar. So I'm gonna keep the history short, but I'm gonna give you a little bit of the history. there we go. So Hanford is this 586 square mile former military reservation located near the Tri-Cities. of Glen Pasco Kennewick in South Central Washington, right there on the Columbia River. And it's where the US government produced plutonium for all of our atomic weapons during World War II and throughout the Cold War. You can go to the next one. It's a little slow. You know, during 1943, we were in the middle of World War II, and the federal government selected this really large area out in what they thought was the middle of nowhere for a couple of reasons. It was part of this top secret Manhattan Project, this race against the Nazis to make the first bomb. And this area was far away from, you know, large population centers. It was located on the river. They were going to need large amounts of water to make plutonium. And it was also near the Grand Coulee Dam, which had been built or completed the year before, and they needed electricity to run what they were going to build. So when the area was finally secured, they got about 50,000 workers out to the area to build the world's first full-scale reactor. It took about 18 months. Of those 50,000 people that were building the reactor, only about 500 people knew what they were actually building. That's how top secret the project was. And yet, 18 months later, they had this miraculously working reactor that was producing plutonium. Pretty incredible, you know, just the engineering feat alone. And the plutonium from this reactor would go into the first bomb test at the Trinity site in New Mexico. And then next slide. And it would also go into the Fat Man bomb that was dropped on Nagasaki, Japan, August 9th, 1945. And what we might see now as sort of an atrocity back then was seen as a victory. You know, World War II ended shortly after that. I think we'll go to the next one. And because of the success of the B reactor, throughout the Cold War, the government decided to build 8 more reactors along the Columbia River to produce plutonium. And, you know, it's estimated that enough plutonium was made at the Hanford site to fuel 30,000 weapons in our atomic arsenal. Certainly enough for world annihilation. Thank goodness that it didn't come to that. Let's see, I think we can go to the next one. And this was the end product. This is what came out of it. It was called the plutonium button. Just a little disc, size of a hockey puck. And it's kind of interesting that went into our atomic weapons. But a lot of what you don't hear is what else came out of the site. It wasn't just these plutonium buttons. It was a lot of pollution. Next one. So every step of the plutonium production process created unprecedented volumes of liquid and solid wastes. The most harmful of those wastes was stored in the center of the site in these underground tanks, about 7 miles from the river. And what didn't go into these tanks just went straight into the environment.
How many miles from the river was it?
7 miles. Those tanks are still there. We'll talk about them. So the reactors needed large volumes of water, like I was saying. And instead of, you know, doing something with that radioactive water that was coming out of the reactors, it just went straight into the river. And then there were hundreds of these liquid disposal sites all over this 586 square mile piece of property where those chemical and those radioactive wastes were just dumped straight into the soil. And then there were hundreds of these solid burial grounds around the site as well, where they, you know, they would dispose of tools and, you know, personal protection gear. They even found an entire train buried at Hanford, a radioactive train. And really, the hole they were put, you know, which is really crazy. Let's see. And all right. Well, before we talk to cleanup, kind of lost my spot. Oh, so before I want to talk about cleanup, I do just want to say that at the end of the Cold War in 1989, the Hanford site was considered the most contaminated site in the United States. It's estimated that over 500 contaminated facilities, including the 9 reactors, were on the site, and that roughly 450 billion gallons and billion, I want to stress that B, billion gallons of contaminated liquids were discharged into the river, into the soil, just into the environment, some unintentionally, but quite a bit of it intentionally. And even today, we know this as the most contaminated site in the state of Washington, in the Pacific Northwest, in the United States, in the Western Hemisphere. So we're looking at one of the most contaminated sites in the world. Oh, okay, and this is the part of my presentation where I ask everyone to take a deep breath and just let that out, because I just told you live not too far away from the most contaminated site, and yet nobody's panicking or running out of the room. We're properly desensitized to all the other issues in our world, is basically what you're telling me. And I'm protecting it, so that's great. So in 1989, when we were no longer producing plutonium, we had to figure out how to clean up the site. So the Department of Energy, who's the responsible party, the Environmental Protection Agency, and the Department of Ecology, they got together and they formed what is called the Tri-Party Agreement. And it's basically this document that kind of outlined how they were going to clean up the site. And they were estimating at the time it would take about 30 years and a top range of $50 billion to clean this up. But I don't think they really knew exactly what was there and how long it would take. So, let's go forward one. I want to fast forward to today. It's 2015. We're 26 years into the cleanup. And I want you to just look at this site map real quick to kind of get an idea of what I'm talking about. The Hanford is separated into these three cleanup areas. There's the river corridor, which at the top is called the 100 areas. That's where all the reactors are located, the 9 reactors. And then kind of down in the bottom, that darker yellow place that's in the river corridor, that's the 300 area. That's where all the uranium was manufactured before they turned it into plutonium. And then in the center of the site, it's called the plateau. That's the 200 area. That's where all the tanks are located. There's a massive landfill. There's a waste treatment plant. And there's lots of other facilities like plutonium processing canyons, which were 1,200 feet long, 8-story high. These are the types of buildings that they're trying to demolish and clean up. And I want to talk briefly about the successes of cleanup, what has happened so far, because I think that's really important. And I think a lot of credit is due to all the workers that are out there risking their health every day to clean the site up, and also to the engineers and the scientists, that are trying to find innovative ways to figure out, what's going to happen to all this waste. So the Department of Energy so far has stopped dumping radioactive waste into the soil. So this was actually happening until 1997, so past the 89 mark. They've moved all the spent fuel away from the river into dry storage. They've demolished hundreds of contaminated buildings. And they've moved millions of tons of contaminated soil that was next to the river, away from the river, to the center of the site, in the central plateau, into a lined landfill. So they're no longer just dumping it into unlined landfills. And then there's been a lot of successes on treating contaminated groundwater, which we'll talk about in a minute. And this little graph up here, this is from the Department of Energy. They release this colorful graphic every year that shows us, what they've done for the year 14, what's happened before, what's going to come in the future. And I think that's always great, but what the Department of Energy doesn't always tell you, and possibly for good reason, are the huge challenges that are remaining on Hanford. And it's going to be much longer than 4 more years until cleanup is complete. So I'm going to a couple of those. So currently there's the reactors, six of the nine reactors are cocooned. Most of them should have been cocooned, and this basically means the reactor structures have been torn down to their center. They're going to keep them in these like concrete, sort of graves, and that allows the radiation to dissipate so that the workers can actually go in and demolish them. They're going to be in the state for decades. There are 177 underground storage tanks in the center of the site that contain 56 million gallons of the most toxic waste man has ever created. It's just a slurry of goo, of sludge, it's almost a nightmare. We know that several of those tanks have already leaked into the soil, about a million gallons of this, and it has made its way down through the soil and into the groundwater. Let's go to the next one. This is an issue because the waste treatment plant, which is designed to turn all of that liquid waste in the tanks into glass, into a more stable form, is about 19 years behind schedule and about $8 billion over budget. Must be government. I heard it.
No wonder they don't have any money for anything else.
So the only reason why the public knows that this treatment plant is behind schedule is because there was actually a whistleblower that came forward and said, I think there are these design issues, these engineering issues that we're just trying to, fumble through. But I'm afraid that if we build this plant in its current design, hydrogen is the potential for a huge explosion. Now, this site isn't that far from the city of Richland, and there are currently about 11,000 workers on site, so it was in the best interest of the whistleblower, basically, to alert people of what was happening and saying we need to protect our workers and the people that live nearby. And essentially that shut the construction of the plant down. They're still working through those issues. We're hoping to have glass being made in 2011. Now they're thinking they're going to maybe start making glass in 2022, maybe 2025. Maybe never. They may have to actually scrap this entire project, which they have put billions of dollars into. Let's go to the next one. Next up. So another really big remaining challenge is the groundwater. Remember kind of all of those unlined pits I was talking about that they were just dumping liquid into, trenches and injection wells? Well, thanks to gravity and time, all of that waste seeped through the soil and hit the groundwater. And all of that groundwater is moving toward the Columbia River. And we actually know that it's currently entering. Here's a picture of the groundwater plumes. You can see where in the central area where the tanks are. And then up in the north, where the reactors are, you can see sort of little smudges of color. There's a lot of waste in the soil there near the reactors that's entering the river, like strontium 90, hexavalent chromium, things that are not good for, people or fish. 70 square miles of this stuff. Now they are having success with pump and treat, but some recent decisions from energy on their cleanup plan suggest that they should just leave this in the ground and in the groundwater because it will save money. And not everybody really agrees with that. It's not taking an active approach, and it's using the river as what they like to say the solution to pollution is dilution, right? So just letting it go in the river over time. So why am I here telling you all this bad news, not making anybody laugh, because this is hard stuff to hear. Let's go to the next one. I think one before the other. So I'm going to bring this back to the river because I am a river keeper. So in this area is the Hanford Reach. Now, I saw a couple hands up. You guys have been out in this area. The reach is this 50-mile free-flowing section of the river that runs. It's kind of kind of one of the only areas on the Columbia where the river still acts like a river because the dams are so far apart. Yeah. And because of that, it is home to hundreds of bird species and mammal species. It's really critical. It's also one of the most productive spawning grounds for Chinook salmon on the Columbia River, producing about 50 million juvenile salmon every year. And they're spawning right next to where these contaminated groundwater plumes are seeping out of the soil and getting into the river. So who is a salmon eater here, or goes fishing on the Columbia, or loves fish, you know? I mean, we know that right now we're not finding, you know, levels of contamination in the river that would, you know, send up red flags, because it's a huge, you know, volume of water that's diluting that, but it still can seem concerning to know that this stuff is entering our river and there's no boundary on the Columbia where pollution stops. You know, it just keeps coming downstream. And there are communities that use the Columbia water for drinking water. There's 50,000 residents in Richland that drink this water. I'm gonna go to the next one. We've got farms that irrigate with the Columbia River. They actually recently found tritium, which is a radium applied in Washington. And they are attributing it to the Hanford site. Now, it's at very, very low levels that aren't harmful to human health. But what does that mean? And does anybody want to know that they're drinking radioactive wine? No.
Do you?
No.
Does it glow?
Yeah, and it doesn't glow. The wine... Okay, we can go to the next one. which brings me to, you know, sort of the end of this. A lot of people call the Columbia River like the lifeblood of the Northwest, right? Like, it's part of our way of life. You know, we love to go fishing, we love to recreate on it, and it's a freshwater resource. And as, you know, things are happening in California, right? You're hearing about all these droughts in California. Now we're having drought warnings in Washington and Oregon. And we're going to continue to rely on our Columbia River, you know, as a freshwater resource and as a resource for our fish. So it's incredibly important that we protect it. And I like to kind of have this little last slide, the don't panic slide. That's me sitting at the B reactor about to push the panic button. I love that photo. The reason why I don't worry quite so much, even though it's a worrying subject, is that the public has been instrumental in some of the cleanup decisions that have happened out on the Hanford site. Because of the public, it's not a repository for all of our high-level nuclear waste around the country that was proposed at one point, so we're not bringing more waste to the site. It's not a repository for our the United States mercury, which at one point it was suggested that we send all of the mercury waste from around the United States and put it at the Hanford site, which seems crazy to me to store tons of mercury near a freshwater resource with lots of fish in it. And then the public has been instrumental in ensuring that groundwater is being treated. Before then, the government really wasn't doing much about the groundwater, but they're now doing pump and treat systems. So I'm basically here to say, get involved. You know, be part of that public voice that's ensuring that Hanford is cleaning, you know, getting cleaned up. I've got a thank you letter to our Washington state leaders, which you can sign. They're holding the Department of Energy accountable to their deadlines, and if you'd like to sign it, we would love that. And then you can ask me questions more on how to get involved.
Can you stick around?
And I will, of course, stick around.
Okay.
So,
if anybody has any questions, you'll stick around.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
On behalf of the Pioneer Lions, I want to present you with this here mug for your favorite beverage.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. I love it.
Columbia River Water.
Columbia River Water.
Radioactive One.
And Radioactive One. I drink.
Our blue ticket, 721787. Harry. So we'll go to the red ticket, 785646. Jan. Golden Ear.
This is great. Got my new mug.
Okay, Greg first got the sign-ups for the chuck wagon coming up. Sign up over there at the back wagon there, or the table. Greg Swanson's got the Spirits of Longview. Got those sign-ups back there. Rex, do you have a sign-up sheet for the, for the ice cream wagon? Dick Sorens, we got the campus towers coming up this weekend. We also have a board meeting, 7 a.m., 8 a.m. is the campus towers. Got the golf, go forth buttons, the kickoff for the zone chairman coming up on the 30th. That's all I have. Who, Eric, what'd you get?
Ace of spades.
Ace of spades? Well, there's no other business. This meeting is adjourned.